Hi, welcome back to Mastering Anaesthesia. If you clicked on this video, you're probably here to learn about trainee 4. And you're in the right place, because we're going to talk about what it is, why do we do trainee 4, how do we do it, the different patterns and interpretations. So make sure you watch till the very end. Let's go! What is trainee 4? Trainee 4 is one of the modalities in peripheral nerve stimulation to assess for the degree of neuromuscular blockade on patients who receive neuromuscular blocking drugs. So trainee 4 is just one of the monitoring in peripheral nerve stimulation. There are also single twitch, tetany, and double burst stimulation. So why do we have to monitor peripheral nerve stimulation? Now, first and foremost, there are variation in patient sensitivity to neuromuscular blocking agents. Some are more sensitive, whereas some are not so sensitive. So to differentiate this, peripheral nerve stimulation will help. Next is to help us in assessing whether the patient is ready to be intubated in rapid sequence induction. And it can also help us anesthetists to help locate the nerves to be blocked in regional anesthesia. Be cautious that there are also contraindications and precautions in peripheral nerve stimulation. First and foremost, make sure that the nerve that we stimulation is not part of the surgical procedure. Caution also needs to be exercised in atrophied muscles. This can be due to areas of hemiplegia, nerve damage, where these muscle groups, they are refractory to neuromuscular blocking agents. Why? Because of the proliferation of receptors. So the use of neuromuscular blocking agents can lead to overdosing of competitive neuromuscular blocking agents. So how do we actually perform peripheral nerve stimulation? So a peripheral nerve stimulator, as you can see on the diagram, delivers a current of 60 to 80 milliamperes, which is supramaximal stimulus. It is delivered via a pair of ECG electrodes placed on the peripheral nerve that we want to stimulate. Thereafter, a mechanical or visual response is observed, either the muscle twitch or graphical representation seen on the monitor of the peripheral nerve stimulator. So it is important in peripheral nerve stimulation that we deliver supramaximal stimulus, which is an electrical stimulation that is intentionally set higher than the minimal current needed to activate the fibers in the peripheral nerve. Why is that so? This is because we want to avoid understimulation and also ensuring all twitch responses are due to neuromuscular blocking effects. So how do we go about estimating the supramaximal stimulus? So the minimum current to activate all fibers is determined and then increasing it by a minimum of 20 to 30%. That will give us a supramaximal stimulus. The nerves commonly used for peripheral nerve stimulation, number one is ulnar nerve. So there are two leads. The first lead is black distal negative, which is placed at the crease of the wrist. And the more proximal, the red in color, is the positive terminal, which is placed slightly about 2.5 cm more proximal to the distal lead and more medially. And after a supramaximal stimulus is introduced, the thumb will start to twitch. This is because the ulnar nerve will supply the adductor pollicis longus. Next most commonly used nerve in peripheral nerve stimulation is the facial nerve. As before, there will be two leads, the distal black negative terminal and the positive proximal red terminal. Distal negative terminal and the proximal positive terminal. So the muscle that will be stimulated is the corrugator supercilii, which can be observed by the twitching of the eyebrow. So therefore, when we want to monitor the level of neuromuscular blockade, it is monitored by applying various patterns of electrical stimulation, whether that is trainee 4, single twitch, double burst stimulation, or tetany, and then monitoring how it looks in the graph. So all stimuli are 200 microseconds or 0.2 milliseconds in duration, square wave pattern, and all of equal current intensity. Let's go to the actual patterns. First one is single twitch, which is a single pulse delivered every 1 to 10 seconds or equivalent to 1 to 0.1 Hz. So there's a single stimulus, about 0.2 milliseconds. So as the block increases, the intensity of the evoke response will reduce. Next, the most popular pattern, the train of 4, which literally means 4 successive stimuli delivered in 2 seconds or 2 Hz. So you have 4 equal stimuli of 0.2 milliseconds with a gap of 0.5 milliseconds. Next electrical stimuli is tetany, which is electrical stimulation delivered at 50 to 100 Hz. Remember Hz meaning number of stimulation per second. So if you want to get the duration between stimuli, all you have to do is say 100 Hz. To get the duration between the stimulation, all you have to do is 1 divided by 100. That will give you the duration in between the stimuli. So this is how the pattern will look like if we administer 100 Hz stimuli. You'll get individual stimuli of 0.2 milliseconds with a gap of 0.01 second or 10 milliseconds. Interpretation-wise, a sustained contraction of 5 seconds or more is equal to adequate reversal from neuromuscular blocking agent. And our last electrical pattern is double burst stimulation, which is basically 3 short high frequency bursts separated by 20 millisecond interval or 50 Hz, followed by a gap of 750 milliseconds, and then by similar 2 such impulses or 3. So how does it look? So as you can see, there will be 3 initial stimuli followed by a gap and then followed by another 2 short stimuli, each stimuli of about 0.2 milliseconds with a gap of 0.2 milliseconds and a large gap of 750 milliseconds before introducing the subsequent short burst of stimuli. So as you can see, the second burst of stimuli can either have 2 stimuli or 3 stimuli. So accordingly, it will be named DBS3-2 or DBS3-3. Now let's analyze the actual train of 4. What can happen if we give non-depolarizing muscle relaxin? The twitch will progressively become lesser, or termed as fade. As you can see, the intensity reduces as non-depolarizing muscle relaxant block increase. So the ratio of the first to the fourth twitch is a sensitive indicator of non-depolarizing muscle relaxant paralysis or degree of reversal. Clinically and visually, we can also determine the degree of blockade by seeing the number of twitch that goes missing or disappear. So the disappearance of certain numbers of twitch will actually signify the percentage of blockade. So if you see here, disappearance of the fourth will signify 75% blockade, the third 80% blockade, and the second will signify 90% neuromuscular blockade. It is helpful for us to know that the clinical relaxation requires about 75 to 95% block. How about adequate reversal then? So by measuring the first to fourth twitch ratio, a ratio of more than 90% will show that the patient can be safely extubated. Final points that are important I need to emphasize are what is fade, post-tetanic potentiation, and a bit about phase 1 and phase 2 block. Fade is a gradual diminution of evoke response following prolonged or repeated nerve stimulation. This can be due to non-depolarizing muscle relaxant block or phase 2 block if we are talking about succinylcholine. And the mechanism is due to prejunctional effect of non-depolarizing muscle relaxant. Here you see the fade. And then what about post-tetanic potentiation? It is basically after tetanic stimulation of non-depolarizing block, the subsequent stimulus has an increased evoke response. As shown here, after a tetany, there will be an increased evoke response. And this can be due to the transient increase in acetylcholine mobilization. And do note that this only occurs in tetanic stimulation and only following non-depolarizing muscle relaxant or phase 2 block. Now moving on to the difference between phase 1 and phase 2 block. Phase 1 happens when you give succinylcholine. So there'll be diminished responses and there'll be no post-tetanic potentiation. Phase 2 block is when you give a larger dose of succinylcholine or prolonged infusion. It is exactly the same as non-depolarizing block, where you will observe fade and there is also post-tetanic potentiation. Thank you so much for watching my video till this very end. If you like my video, please like and comment if you want me to do a specific topic that you want, and subscribe, as your subscription will be very, very precious for the continuation of my channel and new videos coming up soon. So stay tuned, see you in my next video.